Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and seek His help, His guidance and His forgiveness. This chapter concerning a person who been struck and been killed by an arrow thrown by an undefined person. From Imam al-Bukhari with a chain of narration to Umm al-Rubai', the mother of Rubai' bint al-Bara', which is the mother of Haritha bin Suraqa. She came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, O Prophet of Allah, inform me about my son Haritha, which he was killed in the day of Badr through an unidentified person. If he had achieved Jannah, I will be patient. Otherwise, I continue crying and weeping over him. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, what the meaning is, O mother of Haritha, is not only one Jannah, it is many Jannah, and your son had achieved the highest place, which you call Al-Firdaus. Imam al-Bukhari, rahmatullah alayhi, continuing with his narration concerning the virtues and the reward of jihad and those who strive in the cause of Allah. And he brought this hadith to use it as evidence that a person who been struck by an unidentified person, as a result of this, that he been killed, although that he's not in the jihad itself, that he will be considered as a martyr and a shaheed. And Sahd al-Gharb, that means a Sahd that been shot by a person by mistake. And Haritha is the son of Al-Rubai', which we talked about it before. While he was in the Battle of Badr, he went to get some water to drink. One of the kuffar and the mushrikeen saw him, and he shot him with an arrow. As a result of this, he died. So as a result of this, his mother, she was sad, not because he died, but because that when he died, he was not in the battlefield. He was a distance from it. He was not in a physical combat, actually, but he went to drink water. So she came to ask the Prophet ﷺ concerning the result of her son. So if he been rewarded as a martyr, and he will go to Jannah. So this is became a consolence or a condolence for her, not for her to be so excited and so sad. So this information will help her to calm down and to minimize her crying over her son, because she will be happy that he went to Jannah. And of course, nobody will have this except a person he have a good and strong iman. Otherwise, if her son didn't achieve Jannah due to the fact that he was not in the battlefield in this moment when he got killed, there is no anything, the condolence for her to help her to stop weeping and crying. Some of the scholars said that this was concerning before the Prophet ﷺ prohibited the mourning over the dead, which is not correct. Also, at the same time, weeping is something different from mourning. But the Prophet ﷺ had given her the glad tidings and informed her that it's not only a Jannah, a single Jannah, but it's many. As we had stated before, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had prepared in Jannah 100 degrees, especially for those who fight in His cause. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed her that her son Haritha, may Allah be pleased with him, had achieved the highest of all places in Jannah, which is Al-Firdaus. So Imam al-Bukhari, rahmatullahi alayhi, brought this hadith to show the evidence that if a person been killed by accident in the battlefield, he left his house with the intention to be participating in the battlefield, but he didn't reach it, or in his way back, he died, or he fall from his ride, or he been shot or struck by unidentified arrow, that this person still count as a martyr, similar to the person who had died in the battlefield. Wallahu a'lam. This chapter concerning whosoever fights, participate in jihad. So Allah's word will be exalted, i.e. the religion of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be superior. Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi recorded in his collection from Abu Musa, may Allah be pleased with him, that Iman came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and saying or questioning him, O Messenger of Allah, what about a man fights for the booty of the war, while another fights for the fame, and another fight for showing off and to be recognized by people? Which one of this will be in the cause of Allah? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied by saying what the meaning is, whosoever fights for the purpose and the goal that the religion of Allah, the word of Allah, will be the superior, indeed this is the one that in the cause of Allah. This chapter concerning whosoever fights in the cause of Allah for the purpose that the words of Allah will be the superior, that means the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be the highest of all. And the Shaykh hafizahullah wa zada ilman wa hikmah wa sabran ala al-mustami' wal-mutarjim said that this hadith, one of the most important hadith in the collection of Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi concerning the jihad, because this hadith it deals with the sincerity and the pure intention. And as we understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't accept from the good deed anything except what is sincere for his pleasure. And jihad is one of the most important things, because a person, he will give up and sacrifice his life, his property, his family, everything. So if the sincerity and the purpose is not clear in his heart, which is the good intention why he's doing this jihad, this will be a big loss for the person. This man had came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam questioning him, and he had presented different cases that a person may fight because he looking for the spoils of the war, while other person for the fame and the game, and the other person may fighting because he's seeking position and to be seen by the people. Which one of all these people will be in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And this is the reality. You will see a lot of people in the battlefield. The appearance of all of them that they are ready to fight or they are about to fight. But what's in their hearts, nobody knows except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in one of the narration of the hadith came that a person will fight for Hamiya, that he comes because tribalism purpose, that he see his tribe fighting, he will involve and fight, assisting them. He doesn't know even why they're fighting. So this was another narration. And also a person, he may fight due to the fact of anger. So there is more than one purpose why a person will participate in the battlefield. But the Prophet ﷺ didn't answer any of those proposed questions. And the Prophet ﷺ had turned away from all these things. And he gave a short answer, but which was covering and was sufficient and was a healing for the cure. And he said that whosoever fights for the purpose to exalt the word of Allah, this is the person who is fi sabilillah, that be rewarded as a martyr, will be rewarded as for the cause of Allah. And also, he didn't answer all this question because a person may fight out of anger, but anger for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a person may fight for other reasons, but all of them still related to the fact that do it for Allah's cause. And here we come that to see under this category, there is five categories that a person, he may go to fight because he wants elevated the words of Allah and the religion of Allah. But a person also under this, he may go for exalting the words of Allah and the same time that he looking for the spoils of the war, the booty. And a person may go for one of them. And a person may go for one of them, but the other one will come automatically. So if a person going, as example, for the cause of Allah and also for seeking the booty, and both of them are equal in his intention, this is not right. And if a person go for one of them, which is not for Allah's cause by the booty, this is also not correct. And a person had came to ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that a person will go to fight for tribalism, a person will fight for to his position to be seeked and all the things, which one is in the cause of Allah? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informing that none of it is for the sake of Allah. And finally the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, indeed Allah accept from the deed what is only for his sake and seeking his pleasure. So a person who go out of his house for the jihad, he have to go originally and solely for exalting the word of Allah, establishing the deen of Allah. And if the booty came later on as a result of this, alhamdulillah, it is fine. If they didn't come, is no problem. So he shouldn't be going for both of them in the same time, but he have to have the sole purpose of his going out fi sabilillah only for the pleasure of Allah. And if it happened that he gained something out of the battlefield, this is fine. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to encourage the companions after they already had left for the purpose of fighting in the cause of Allah, and telling them that whosoever kill a kafir, whatever that he had on him, this will be for him. And he used to share and give them. After this, we come to talk about the hadith, which is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying the person who fights under a blindly flag, and he die, he will die like the time of Jahiliyyah. That means he went and fought under a call, but he doesn't know what this call for. This person, if he die in the battlefield, this person will die like the time of Jahiliyyah. This doesn't have anything to do with the leadership. The leadership can be wrong. It can be bad leadership, okay? As we may see happening nowadays. But why the soldier or the horseman himself, why did he leave his house? He didn't leave because the leadership. He left because that this fighting itself is permissible, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants the people to go to defend their brothers and their sisters. So for using this hadith that as a reason not to participate in the jihad because the leader is crooked or that he is bad or that he is not a good Muslim, this is not a correct understanding, because the fighting itself is still obligation and still commanded under Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a'lam. Chapter in the collection of Imam al-Bukhari concerning the superiority of him whose feet get covered with dust in the cause of Allah. And the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the meaning is, it was not be coming of the people of Al-Madinah and the Bedouin of the neighborhood to remain behind Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when fighting in Allah's cause. Surely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who are muhsineen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, surely Allah wastes not the reward of al-muhsineen, doers of good. And Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi recorded in his collection from Abd al-Rahman ibn Jabr, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, what the meaning is, anyone whose both feet get covered with dust in Allah's cause will not be touched by hellfire. This chapter concerning a person who covers his feet with dust for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Imam al-Bukhari had continued to tell us about the reward and the virtues of those people who go in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the hadith is talking about a portion of the deed of the mujahid, which is the walking and the covering of the dust to his feet for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what he meant by this, that mean what reward is for him as a result of walking on the earth, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, وَلَا يَرَؤُونَ مَوْطِئًا, and when they step or take steps in any place, because when a person walks, this what cause the dirt or the dust to come out of the dirt, and what's been meant in this verse. So this shows you the reward of a person who his feet being covered by dust, even if he did not participate in the jihad yet, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him by making hellfire forbidden for him. And this had happened in some cases with the Sahaba when they went out for the combat and the fighting, and they returned without any fighting and they had won the battle already. So by walking only, even if the person did not engage in physical fighting, by walking, this will sufficient for them to get such a great reward, which makes them to be, hellfire will be forbidden for them. And after this, he talk about a linguistic point about what is supposed to be about Ghbarrata and Ghbarrat, because you understand that, but still acceptable because this is one of the language of the Arabs, and acceptable. And also he brought about one of the athar or one of the information been inherited concerning the Sahaba. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, may Allah be pleased with him, he went walk with Usama, may Allah be pleased with him, to give him a goodbye before he leaves and participate in the battle. And we understand the position of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq comparing to Usama. And Usama insisted for Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu to ride, because how can he as a young man, as a young Sahabi, to be riding in the horse while Abu Bakr is walking on his feet. But Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was so concerned to practice this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said that he wished for his feet to be covered with dust in the cause of Allah. This shows you how the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with them, used to be so concerned about putting in action the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This chapter concerning a person who covers his feet with dust for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Imam al-Bukhari had continued to tell us about the reward and the virtues of those people who go in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the hadith is talking about a portion of the deed of the mujahid, which is the walking and the covering of the dust to his feet for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what he meant by this, that mean what reward is for him as a result of walking on the earth, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, وَلَا يَرَؤُونَ مَوْطِئًا, and when they step or take steps in any place, because when a person walk, this is what cause the dirt or the dust to come out of the dirt, and what's been meant in this verse. So this shows you the reward of a person who his feet being covered by dust, even if he did not participate in the jihad yet, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him by making hellfire forbidden for him. And this had happened in some cases with the Sahaba when they went out for the combat and the fighting, and they returned without any fighting, and they had won the battle already. So by walking only, even if the person did not engage in physical fighting, by walking, this will sufficient for them to get such a great reward, which makes them to be, hellfire will be forbidden for them. And after this, we talk about a linguistic point about what is supposed to be about Ghbarrata and Ghbarrat, because you understand that, but still acceptable because this is one of the language of the Arabic and acceptable. And also he brought about one of the athar or one of the information been inherited concerning the Sahaba, Abu Bakr Siddiq, may Allah be pleased with him, he went walk with Usama, may Allah be pleased with him, to give him a goodbye before he leaves and participate in the battle. And we understand the position of Abu Bakr Siddiq comparing to Usama. And Usama insisted for Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu to ride, because how can he as a young man, as a young Sahabi, to be riding in the horse while Abu Bakr is walking on his feet. But Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu was so concerned to practice this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said that he wished for his feet to be covered with dust in the cause of Allah. This shows you how the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with them, used to be so concerned about putting in action the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This chapter concerning to remove the dust which falls on one's head while striving in Allah's cause. Rated Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi in his collection, that Ibn Abbas said to him and to Ali Ibn Abdullah, go to Sa'id and learn to what he's going to tell you, him and his brother, while they are in their garden regarding their plants. So when he saw us, he sat down and across his legs, and he said, we used to carry the adobe or the blocks to build a mosque, one by one, one brick by one. While Ammar, may Allah be pleased with him, used to carry double two bricks in the same time. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed by Ammar and removed the dust of his head and said, may Allah have mercy in you, Ammar, the aggressive groups will kill him. Ammar will be inviting them to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he will invite him to hellfire. The second chapter concerning al-ghusl, taking a shower or bath after fighting in Allah's cause, and dust. Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi reported with the isnad narration from Hisham, son of Urwa, from his father, that Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came back from the battle of Al-Khandaq, and he put down his whipping and he took a shower, the angel Gabriel came to him and his head was covered with dust, and he said, you have brought down your arms. By Allah, I have not brought down my arms yet. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him where to go after this. Jibreel alayhi salam said to him, "This way," and he pointed towards the tribe of Banu Qurayza. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam went out towards this direction, which is the angel Jibreel had pointed to it. Allahu alam. This chapter concerning wiping the dust from a person's head, or remove the dust which falls in one head, why a person is striving the cause of Allah. And what Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi meant by this, what is the ruling concerning removing and wiping the dust? Is it permissible if it's disliked? And he brought this hadith due to the fact that the previous hadith was concerning the reward of those people that dirt will cover or dust will cover their feet as a result of walking in the cause of Allah. So may this will come to somebody and make him assuming that he could not remove this dust because such a great reward he will receive as a result of it. And maybe because some people understood, some people from the Salaf understood that a person is not supposed to dry his limbs after making wudu, because in some narration came that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after he finished his wudu, he'd been given something similar to a towel, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't want it. So they understood from this, a person is not supposed to dry his limbs after his wudu, but this is not correct because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam refused it because he has no need to use it. And there's a difference between the wudu and the jihad. The wudu is a something necessity for making the salah, but the dirt or the dust is not a necessity for establishing the jihad. So, from this we understand there is no need for a person to keep the dust in his limbs for him to take and achieve the reward of the previous hadith. And after this he brought with this hadith of Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, when he told him to go, him and Ali, and to listen and to get the hadith. That Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, he said to Ali and to Abdullah to go to Sa'id and to listen from him. And this was the manner and the behavior of the Sahaba, may Allah be with them. They used to send and encourage the people to go to those who had heard the hadith directly from the mouth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those who are more knowledgeable, for them to get the hadith directly from them. And also it shows us how Sa'id, may Allah be pleased with them, welcome them due to their position and their relatives or the relationship, family relationship between Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said, and he started to inform them about some of the narration which he knows about it, and he told them about when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave the order of building the mosque, how the people used to carry the blocks one by one, but Ammar, may Allah be pleased with him, he used to carry two blocks in the same time. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he passed by Ammar, he wiped the dust and removed it from his head. And again, it shows you the permissibility of removing this dust and it not have to remain there. And also, this shows how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was pleased with Ammar for what he was doing. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by his saying woe to Ammar, this also was indication and the prophecies of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which he had informed us about the war that will take place between two armies of the Muslims. One is oppressed and one is a transgressor. And that Ammar will be killed by the wrong party. And in actuality, what had took place, that Ammar, he fought in the side of Ali against Muawiyah, and he'd been killed by the other group. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muawiyah, and he been killed by the other group. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say that Ammar is inviting them to obey Allah, and what he meant by this mean to obey the Imam of the Muslims, and this what leads to Jannah. And also the other group was inviting Ammar to go to hellfire, i.e. by disobeying the Imam. Excuse me. Because the disobedience of Imam of the Muslims, this can cause the person to be in hellfire. Also, the hadith, although that doesn't have here something concerning the fighting is the cause of Allah, but it shows that the mosque and building the mosque, one of the things which he intended for pleasing Allah, for the pleasure of Allah, and that anything in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the dirt that coming out of it, it can be removed, although that this is for the sake of Allah, so there is no harm to remove this dirt or this dust. You don't have to keep it all the time on your body, and Allah knows best. Wallahu alam. And the evidence in this hadith is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he took a bath or shower after he had finished the battle. But while after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took a shower, that which caused for the dust to be removed from his body, which was the dust in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the angel Jibreel had came to him. And the angel Jibreel came, as hadith is saying, whose head was covered with dust. And he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have put down your arms. That mean like was surprising to see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam already had took off his fighting equipment of, and Jibreel alayhi salam used to come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in different forms and a strange form which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not recognize it immediately, and sometimes he used to come in a form of a man, like a person called Yahya al-Kalbi, and we used to come in this form, the companion, you will see him and recognize him. And the angel testified to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said to him, and we see here that Jibreel alayhi salam, he said that he will still continue, he didn't fish, and that dust was covering his head. So this shows you the angels who used to participate in the jihad. So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how come you did this? And we didn't finish. We're still fighting against the kuffar and the mushrikeen. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, and he pointed to him towards the people of Bani Quraysh. And what happened in this battle, which called the ditch or the ghazwa or the battle of Al-Khandaq, which caused a lot of hardship and difficulty for the Muslims, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have a treaty with those people of Ben Quraiza already. So they betrayed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they inclined towards the mushrikun, and they fought against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and surprising him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned some things of this battle in the Quran, and he said how spacious the air is, but it felt so tight, and that your heart had reached the jugular vein, and the believer has been a serious test in this battle. So here the Sheikh saying, look, if this is the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the best human being and the most closer to Allah, and the companions for him are the best people after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it happened to them what had happened in this battle, and they've been tested in a serious way. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that bin zulzilu, it did be shaken like an earthquake. So what happened to us nowadays is a test of Allah. And if it happened to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we shouldn't be surprised that can happen to us. We are not better than the Sahaba. So we have to wait in Allah's release. And we have to have endurance and patience. And after this, we see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wore his armors and he went where Jibreel alayhi salam had pointed to him to continue the battlefield. But basically, the shahid, or the most important thing why this hadith been mentioned here, to show you that the person, after fighting in the cause of Allah, he can take bath and he can remove the dirt or the dust that had fallen in him while he participating in jihad. Wallahu alam. This chapter concerning the superiority and the great reward for those people who've been killed in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Al Imran, Surah number 3, verse 169 to verse 179. The statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the meaning is, seek not of those who are killed in the way of Allah as dead, nay, they are alive with their Lord, and they have provision. They rejoice in what Allah has bestowed upon them of His bounty, and rejoice for the sake of those who have not yet joined Him, but are left behind, i.e., not been martyred, that on them no fear shall come, nor shall they grieve. They rejoice in grace and bounty from Allah, and Allah will not waste the reward of the believers. Imam al-Bukhari, rahmatullahi alayh, narrated in his collection that Anas ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, said that the part of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, made dua against the types of Ra'al and Zakwan wa Asiyah, those people who had killed the people of the well of Ma'una. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam invoked the curse of Allah against them for 30 days. A verse in Quran, we used to recite it, which has been abrogated later on, concerning those people who had been killed from the Sahaba, inform our people that we have met our Lord. He is pleased us, and we had made us, and He had made us pleased. He is pleased with us, and He has made us pleased. Imam Bukhari, rahmatullahi alayh, narrated in his collection from Jabir ibn Abdullah, may Allah release him and his father, the sum of the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with them, had drank alcohol in the morning of the day of the Battle of Badr, of Uhud, the Battle of Uhud. And they were martyred, killed in the Bilillah, in the cause of Allah. The narrator of the hadith been questioned, they've been killed fi sabilillah in the same day where they drank the wine. He replied, such information does not occur in the narration. Wallahu a'lam. Imam Bukhari, rahmatullahi alayhi, came with a chapter concerning the virtues of the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the superiority of those people who, for whom the following statements of Allah had sent, not those who killed in the way of Allah as dead. And this is not meant virtues of the verse, but what Imam Bukhari brought it here to show the superiority and virtues and the reward and the blessings for those whom been killed for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not the virtues of the verse itself. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to prepare a life for them which we call a barzakh life, which nobody knows the reality except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are alive with Allah, alive before Allah, in a manner no one knows how except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had made their souls to be inside a green bird, which is a fly in Jannah, enjoy and rejoice all the blessings there. They have no fear, they are not worried about their children, their wives, those people who had left behind them. And also they rejoice for those who did not reach them in martyrdom. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had promised them a great reward. After this, البخاري رحمه الله عليه about حديث of نفس ابن مالك may Allah be pleased with him concerning بئر معونة and the reciters of the Quran, the 70 have been killed, and we had mentioned this before. And he mentioning 30 days, and in the other one had mentioned 40 days, and this is no contradiction here, because in one also came as a month, and it's expression about that mean for a long time the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continuing making dua al-qunut against the tribes who had killed the reciters, the hafiz of the Quran. And also here it shows that the abrogation of the verse been abrogated in the citation, but the ruling is still there with the reward that Allah is pleased with him and they are pleased with Allah. After this, Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayh, he brought hadith from Amr that he heard from Jabir ibn Abdullah that some of the companions had drank wine, and after this they went to the battlefield in the day of Uhud, and they passed away, they been killed in the day, and also that this verse had covered him. But here is no surprising, because for them be drinking the wine, this was before Allah had prohibited. And they've been killed, some they said no, they drank it and they've been killed, and Allah forgave them for this because they became a martyr. But we understand that the battle of Uhud, that the wine is not being forbidden until later on after the battle of Uhud. So when the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, they drank the wine, they did not drink it, what was forbidden. And we understand that some of the Sahara, even, they used not to drink wine even before Allah forbade, so they did not drink it in Jahiliyyah or in Al-Islam before it became lawful or became forbidden, like Abu Bakr Siddiq, as example, may Allah be pleased with him and others. But anyway, we understand that Allah said, we never punish a nation until we send a messenger to them. So since there was no narration or anything against the wine, fed it in that time, and companions had drank before they go to the battlefield, that was no harm, no sin, only because there was no any formation came to make wine prohibited in the time and Allah's best. These crusaders, which they try to get the Islam and the Muslims, had already killed the news reporters and put fear on the others. So now we have only one source of information, and we could not trust this information. So in actuality, what is going on here, nobody can tell. Nobody can tell what is going on. So the Sheikh saying, but as before, we know that that this is a war against people who are Muslims, and the duty of the Muslims is to defend them as much as possible, even if they have nobody else to assist him except his own self, which we talk about it later on, inshallah. And as an evidence to what I'm saying, say that, you know, that we don't know where is Saddam now, we don't know where is this millions of soldiers, all the things, how they disappear suddenly like this. We really could not tell you what is going on now, but if we're talking about before, that this is a real jihad, doesn't matter who's in the charge. Doesn't matter who is the leader, doesn't matter if you're a good Muslim or a bad Muslim, because this is offensive jihad, this is defensive jihad, and this obligation upon the people who are there to defend themselves and their families and their property, as well as their neighbors and any other Muslim who can assist. This is their obligation. The Sheikh said that doesn't matter who again in a charge, because this is not offensive jihad, this is a defensive jihad. You don't have to have a flag. You can be fighting under your own flag. And it's no anybody can say that there is condition for this type of jihad. And anybody claim to be from the people of knowledge and say, yes, he doesn't know what he's talking about. And all the scholars agree that jihad for defensive, defensive jihad is a must and doesn't need any condition. All of them agree about it. And if you want to see this information, go to the original sources like the book of Ibn Taymiyyah, Rahmatullahi alayhi, his book of jihad, and read there. So basically, we have to understand that it doesn't matter who's there, that it is obligation on you to fight and to defend the Muslims and just defend the people who are looking for help and assistance. And those who are doing jihad here, this is a jihad, no doubt. And also he said that young son shouldn't worry about the numbers, okay? Because the victory is from Allah, it's not by the numbers. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants for the war to continue for 14 days, this will disable all the equipment of the enemies. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, how little group of people that conquer a great number of people, and that victory is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we mentioned in our classes that victory are by obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is not by number. مرحبا يا شيخ الكلام متكرر. Again, the Sheikh is saying that if something happened to a Muslim, the Muslim in any place, it is obligation upon this area to defend themselves. There is no need for permission or condition. If they are unable to defend themselves, the obligation will fall in their neighbor and closer to them and continue like this. So it is obligation for those who are present there to do so. Now, if the people of Iraq, for example, are not capable to do, and the need for other people surrounding them come, it became a must upon the people surrounding them. But if somebody go voluntarily now, because we did not see all the people rocking out to defend themselves, so if anybody want to go voluntarily, this is fine. And if he have a Islamic leaders in his country, it's his obligation to ask for permission first before to go. But if he's not Islamically is imam, and this is not a must, so there is no need for him, understand, to ask permission. Again, I keep repeating again and again, defensive jihad doesn't need a permission from the ruler, doesn't need any conditions, and Allah knows that. And also we see about those people who assist the kuffar against the Muslim, they have one of two conditions, that they are fasiq or they are kafir, they are sinners. If they have a reason to say that we're doing this for whatever reason, they are not doing it. But if they're doing it for the love of supporting the non-Muslims against the Muslim, this will take them out of the fold of Islam, and we ask Allah's protection. Again, the Sheikh says that if the local area could not defend themselves, now became obligatory upon the surrounded area to come to their aid, and they don't need to seek permission from the leader of such area. What is the ruling concerning the person who assisted the kuffar in killing the Muslims? He say the same thing like the person who assisted them by their land or whatever other means. He is a sinner, fasiq, or he is a kafir. It depends what is his intention for doing so. So he'd be one of these two. The statement or question that the Prophet ﷺ didn't fight while he was in Mecca, due to the fact, the weakness of the Muslims, but when they went to Medina and they became a strength, now they're allowed to fight or they fought. So, as if he's trying to say that Muslims, as long as they are weak, they are not supposed to fight. But here the Sheikh is saying that the Prophet ﷺ was not ordered to fight while he was in Mecca, but it's not only because weakness. Otherwise, we can see that the Prophet ﷺ, after he went to Medina, an example in the Battle of Badr, the number of the Sahaba compared to the kuffar was little, but he wrote also and he wrote. So this is not the conditions. And in other battles that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had defeated the enemy with the large number and equipment that he have without even any fight. So this is not so. And if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam want to do this while he was in Mecca, if he permitted, he will do so. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows this. The question concerning should we correct the aqid of the people first or we go jihad first? And Sheikh say, inshallah, we go in this in details, but in summary, if you're talking about defensive jihad, of course, you have to go for a defensive jihad without waiting for correcting the aqidah, and whenever you see something objectionable, you will advise the people. And we should not be waiting, you understand, for this until people to be put. As for the jihad, of course, that person needs to be corrected, the passing, and we have the hadith, person who just came to Islam, and he jumped in the battlefield before even he do Salah or fasting or anything like this. Allah knows.